Succession Expanded brings a total of 6 new succession types to Crusader Kings 3, as well as some new historical events and changes to existing laws. So I'll try and go over all of this and keep it as short as possible. But this is actually the second part of the Expanded mod series. The first, of course, being Ethnicities and Portraits Expanded. So you know it has some of the best modders working on it, and it really shows. I just want to quickly say, if you are new around here, do consider subscribing to keep up to date with all the brand new CK3 mods and such. Anyway, firstly, I'll cover the most important part, all the new succession laws available. The first is the Imperial Elective. Be aware, this is only available for the Byzantine Empire and the Roman Empires, and there is some slight differences between them both, but with this one, you will notice is now voting power that each elector will have, and there's only a slight difference between them. Inside of the Byzantine Empire, a character's marshal will boost their voting power, and inside of the Roman Empire, it's diplomacy. And in either one, any of your counselors that vote will have the voting power depending on how good they are at that specific job. Now, your voting power, no matter what empire, will be based on your diplomacy. So that is definitely something you will need to slightly focus on, just to make sure you get the elections to go in your favor. And a simple way to actually break down their voting power is to hover over it. And in the 1066 start date, the emperor has some big penalties for being deformed and not having the born in purple trait. And I do really like this one, as I've always thought that big empires like the Byzantines should really have more flavor unique to them. And I do think one day it will happen. It's nice to just get some of that now. Moving on, next we have the Royal Elective Law. And this is a smaller addition, but they do say it wants to loosely bring the inheritance systems of medieval kingdoms, such as Poland, Hungary, and Aragon. So this allows electors to vote from close family, extended family, and even claimants of that title. So you are definitely going to want to keep claims on your title to a minimum to avoid any frustrating moments in the future. But be aware, powerful vassals will lose 15 opinion of you, as they don't really have a chance to get on the throne, say, compared to the typical feudal elective style, where they can actually nominate between themselves. Although I do actually think this one is much better to manage, though, as the vast majority of people that can get nominated will be inside of your family. The next law is tied to members of the Mongolic or Turkish culture groups, and it's the Mongolic Elective. This allows you and all of your direct vassal to nominate the next one onto the throne. Typically, the only people that can get nominated will be from the ruler's own house or any claimants to the throne. But if you do actually have no family at all available, the vassals will actually vote on each other. And this should be fairly okay to get your own way, as everyone's voting power is exactly 1, except the ruler, who will have a total of 10. So if you manage to just keep a few electors that are friends, you'll have no trouble actually deciding who goes on the throne next. Outremer Elective is probably the hardest to actually get, but it's really nice they even added something for this culture. But this type gives the ruler and all direct vassals 2 votes, and any other de jure vassals of the same faith 1 vote. Although, be aware, if any of your dynasty members are in the line of succession for another title, they cannot actually join in and vote for this election. I just really like how they've even gone above and beyond and added new laws for, like, really, like, small and unlikely to come across cultures. Next up, we have Eldership, and this is for some of the tribal rulers around West Africa and the Vidalist Baltic State. And this law only allows candidates from the ruler's dynasty, and all voting power is completely equal. So in one way, it does kind of make things easier with dynasty-only candidates. But then you'll most likely need some friends or hooks to actually get the next ruler you want. And the last one is the Mahestan Elective. And this can only be used by Persian rulers that are in one of the Zoroastrian faiths. It allows all de jure vassal to nominate between the ruler's current dynasty. Although it's actually pretty useful, as voters will typically prefer people who are close family, so getting the children nominated can actually be made easier using this. And things like being an influential vassal and being a part of your dynasty will actually give electors more voting power during elections. Now, with all the brand new succession laws out of the way, let's talk about the addition of co-kingship. Now, to enable it, you will need the hereditary rule innovation and have the feudal elective law. And just be aware, France does already start with co-kingship in 1066, so the decision won't appear for you. But once your dynasty has a level of splendor of at least 4, as well as all the other things we just talked about, you can adopt co-kingship. Now, your vassals will actually lose 30 opinion of you for taking this decision, but you literally gain a plus 100 voting power. So this basically means you have practically total control over the future rulers at the expense of some other vassals' opinions. So you may have to do some more managing with your vassals, but you can really pick and choose who you want next. There is actually some smaller things you probably will notice, like they have modified some decisions, like the one to restore the Carolingian borders. Now, doing this actually enables primogeniture and unlocks some innovations for you. Of course, after taking control of some areas like northern Italy to Frisia. Now, this does actually look like it could be a lot of fun to attempt in the future, but they have actually edited some other decisions too. Now, the last thing I actually do want to mention is the addition of the new historical game rule. It'll activate for you if you do play as Ludwig, or even the AI if you are not. And this will just add some new event pop-ups to explain what's going on and who gets what for the mess that is the Carling dynasty in 867 AD. As well as that, it actually assigns the appropriate succession laws to each kingdom once they do get inherited and change hands and so on. So it just kind of tidies up the area a little bit more. Like, there's really just so much here. They've added a lot. And there's even more than I've mentioned. And mods like these just really give you so many more ideas for playthroughs. And they can really just bring you some unique experiences you cannot get in vanilla. Anyway, thank you so much for watching. Hopefully you did enjoy. And of course, I'm going to end the video with a massive, massive thank you to all the channel members. We have Bayek von Quark, Arcane, Damien, Intermio 1, Irrelevant, Luke Jarrett, and Zigadelic. But yeah, thank you all so, so much for watching. And hopefully, I'll see you in the next one.